We will leapfrog several years from the old phenomenological models to the most recent efforts in trying to model the high energy emission of pulsars. Now, this is based on numerical solutions of pulsar magnetosphere and populating the pulsar magnetosphere with particles using also numerical methods. So the most recent work on this is Filipov and Spitkovsky this year, and I will draw mostly from that work. And the basis for this work has been building up over some time, so one can go back to some of these papers to get some background on what has been used here. So these are called particle in-cell simulations of pulsar magnetosphere, and the basis of these simulations is the force-free magnetosphere solution. And force-free magnetosphere solution we have discussed at some length earlier. So we will use those concepts. Now, earlier when we talked about force-free magnetosphere solution, we were not too concerned about how the plasma which is filling the magnetosphere got generated. However, if you want to do PIC, then you have to have a model for how the plasma is being generated and how it is being filling it as a function of position. So the method is that's been followed is you start with a non-rotating vacuum dipole neutron star, and then set the star in rotational motion, and then look at the electric fields that are generated, and then you inject plasma. So in this model, plasma is injected in two ways. You extract some charge from the surface, and that extraction is proportional to the electric field that gets generated on the surface. Then you also have pair creation. So this is the new thing which is now being sort of introduced in a controlled manner in the simulations in the PIC. So pair creation is attributed to two processes which we have already discussed. One is magnetic conversion, where a photon can split by interacting with magnetic field, and two photon decays, so, gamma-gamma interaction giving rise to pairs. So these two are introduced in some kind of effective fashion in the model.
Father?
Yeah.
So when you say extraction of charge from stellar surface, so how are they changing that? Like, you need to know the properties of the surface?
No, it's just a heuristic model where the extraction rate is proportional to the electric field at the surface.
Okay.
So no surface physics is being used. It's just some rate which has been set. It's a parameter.
So it's a parameter. So,
so all of these are parameters.
Yeah, so if they are not saying it from the surface, they are just saying that in the gap, this amount of charges has to be produced.
Yeah, so they are introducing at the surface
These are the seed charges which are required, which will be accelerated in the gap.
Correct. So the sign of the charge and the quantity of charge is decided based on the electric field that is being produced at the surface.
Okay.
That's all. There are numerical limitations which come to in a moment. But the simulation as being done currently is not being done for true realistic parameters of pulsars, but some scaled parameters of pulsars.
There are no gaps, right, so far?
Yeah, but when you include GR, there is uncompensated E dot B near the surface. So therefore, you can always use that to decide what is the rate at which you are injecting particles.
Right.
If E dot B was completely zero at the surface, then there will be no particle injection.
So basically, there's taking the source of the seed charged particles to be the surface.
That is one, yes. But then you have pairs which produce most of the later generation.
So the seed electrons, when accelerated in the gap, will give rise to this primary pairs. No?
Yes, that's right.
It did start actually in general when they start with a vacuum dipole, that automatically they have some electric field outside, right, on
yeah.
the surface.
Yeah.
So whatever the electric field, that first electric field comes, then the charge particle.
Then they introduce charges, and then the
charge
charges modify the electric field.
Yes, that is a state.
And so it's
state
an iterative
process, right?
And then you will converge to a certain.
And in the process,
standards.
The gap should come out automatically.
Yeah. So. You keep injecting charges, and you also at the outer boundary of the solution of the computation domain, you have an absorbing boundary condition. So anything that reaches the outer boundary is just removed from the calculation. So charges move and basically go out of the computation box. So there's a current. So this produces a current. And the intensity of the current will then depend on the local field conditions.
Oh, so when these charges goes out of the computation box, so these charges are being introduced spontaneously?
Well, that is part of the model. You are continuously injecting charges based on how much electric field there is.
Okay.
So if the electric field goes down, then the amount of charging injection will become lower. So when you start with the vacuum, you inject a huge amount of charge. But when the plasma is established, space charge is established in the magnetosphere, the voltage goes down and you introduce less and less charges. And then you let this process continue until the steady state establishes. And that happens very quickly in this calculation. Within one or two rotations, you come to a situation where you now have a steady state flow. And then you impose force-free conditions, which we have already discussed at some length. And also, you keep space for the current shape, because force-free solution will not be consistent unless you allow return currents to flow. And then allow the solution to settle to a steady state. So that then establishes the magnetospheric condition along with the charge injection.
Solve the problem.
And then you have all these charged particles in the magnetosphere. Then you follow the escaping radiation of charges in the magnetosphere. Radiation in this model, only synchrotron radiation and curvature radiation are being used. Now, because the charges produce radiation, they will lose energy. So this is incorporated using a radiation reaction force on the dynamics of the charge particle. However, all of this is done currently with scaled down parameters. Just to compare, if you take the crab, the primary Lorentz factors will lie in the range 10 to the 6 to 10 to the power of 10. In the simulation, the primary Lorentz factors are limited to between 20 to 500. Beyond that, it cannot be tracked right now. So, in a sense, this is a qualitative analog of the pulsar high energy emission model. But to get to true quantitative representation, many orders of scaling would be required. Okay. So, modeling of dynamics and radiation for individual charged particles. Straightforward. You have, this is the momentum. So the moment, the rate of change of momentum, which is the force, the Lorentz force, plus the radiation reaction force. So radiation reaction is explicitly included to keep track of the energy loss of the particle due to radiation. And the radiation reaction force is given by this. This is a standard expression, which is which is available also in Langlois reactions, for example. So we don't explicitly use it in astronomical calculations often, because the dynamical time scale and the energy loss time scales are usually quite different. So when we talk about synchrotron radiation from a particle, in one or two gyrations, we neglect the radiation reaction. But over a long time, we say that the particle is losing energy, so the injected spectrum is changing with time and so on. But if you have to do it consistently, then this is the way to do it. You have to include the radiation reaction at all times. So this accomplishes that effect of energy loss from the body. And the amount of energy loss itself can be computed from the standard synchrotron type formula, which is this. This is the spectrum from an individual particle. And there's this B perpendicular tilde, which appears here. That is written in a generalized form, which is this. This reduces to the component of the magnetic field perpendicular to the momentum of the particle with relativistic transformation in the Lorentz frame of the particle. So that is why this is there. Right? See, your particle is moving in a certain frame.
Right.
Right? You may have defined the magnetic field in another frame. So usually, we are defining the magnetic field in the frame which is corresponding with the star. So, when you want to look at the perpendicular magnetic field that the particle is going to experience, you have to go to the rest frame of the particle.
All
right. Right? So, you transform the magnetic field to that frame. So it's relativistically transformed magnetic field is what is given here. So electric field, when you have a velocity, will transform and give you a magnetic field. But in this form, it is also able to capture curvature radiation. Because if charged particle has to move and follow the curvature of the field line, then it requires acceleration. It requires a force. And that is in the form of an effective electric field, which will make it move in that direction. And that, once you include here, then quantity also represents the effective radiation from curvature radiation. So this net formulation captures both synchrotron and curvature radiation. So, and the nu c, which appears here, is the standard nu c for critical frequency for synchrotron emission or curvature emission, where this B perpendicular parallel, so B perpendicular tilde is either the component of the magnetic field itself or the equivalent acceleration corresponding to the curvature of the field line. So, you have an effective field, virtual field, which will produce the Larmor radius, which is equal to the radius of curvature of the field. So this represents both of them. So now with this then, you have a model for the radiation. Now note, this is the only radiation which is being included in the simulation right now. So there is no component of inverse contour by particle scattering of photons. That's not there.
Can we say that, see, actually with this beta cross E plus beta cross B, that is actually will, it gives us the circular motion part, right? And the beta dot E is a component. So can one, means just if qualitatively want to understand these two components, so one can say that beta dot E.
So one is
curvature.
One is the component which will make it, one component will make it go around the magnetic field in a circle,
right,
which is the perpendicular component of the field itself, and another which will make it go along the magnetic field, which is because of the electric field which is keeping it along the field
trajectory.
Now this is the curvature radiation. The curvature, if the trajectory has to follow a magnetic field, it cannot do it without an effective acceleration. And that is the effective electric field which will then enter this and then model
it. Let's say beta dot E, can we think it as contributing to this curvature radiation?
Yes, it does and contribute to the curvature radiation. Now, E as a whole, E as a whole contributes to the curvature radiation. Without E, the particle will just, follow whatever is the trajectory it's required in the magnetic field, and then the parallel to the magnetic field at any given P perpendicular to the magnetic field at any given point is zero. Mm-hmm. Then it doesn't feel the magnetic field at all.
Yes.
So it will tend to continue in a straight line. Mm-hmm. And if it continues in a straight line, then it will start feeling the magnetic force and start gyrating. But nowhere is it telling you that it will have to follow the curvature of the field line.
Yes.
So to retain the motion, which is no gyration,
but only
along the curvature of the field line, you need a force. Right. And that has to come from an effective electric field. So that field is included. Okay, so now this is it. That is the whole ingredient. Now, the only other ingredient is that at any point of time when a photon is emitted, it is emitted along the current beta of the particle. So that's the only direction that is taken for the emission from the emitting particle. And then you trace. Many of the photons will go into making other pairs, but some of them will escape. And it's the tracing of the trajectories of the emitting, of the escaping photons will then give you the geometry as well as spectrum of the escaping radiation. So now, let's look at where in the magnetosphere all this action is concentrated. So in this parlance, particles which are injected from the surface are called ions. And those which get created in pair cascade are called electrons and positrons. And in these solutions, the geometry is assumed such that positive charges feel a force away from the surface, and negative charges feel a force towards the surface, very close to the star. Of course, this then changes as you go further out, and you get a full pair wind escaping this.
Why the positive charge is? Why is this thing?
It will depend on the direction, angle between your magnetic field and the spin axis. So the sign of the voltage will change
based on
depending on this angle. So the angle that is chosen here gives you basically a positive electric field. So you get positive ions going away, negative ones going towards
the star. Pole, right?
Near the pole.
At a particular pole. Other pole, it will be other way.
No.
It is all around.
Omega dot B is the same in this case. It will not be the other way. It will be the same in both cases.
Yes, so Deepankar. So in this case, so omega dot B is taken to be less than zero, like they're anti-parallel.
No, omega dot B is
only then no, will have
no. It is when it is anti-parallel, you get. Let me remember it right. So
anti-parallel extracts positive.
Anti-parallel extracts ions. Yeah, that is correct.
That extracts ions.
So anti-parallel extracts. So that's correct. Yeah. So that is the geometry that is assumed here.
This is looking down from the spin axis.
No. Spin axis is here. Magnetic axis is there. Okay. So it is. But this particular picture is taken from the Cherry Top paper where GR was not included, so therefore you don't see pairs emitted close to the surface. Not much acceleration close to the power cap. But in the other paper which I was talking about, that is included.
The Daron's thing.
Not Daron's thing.
Philipov.
So that is
basically local solution of Aron's got created when GR was incorporated, right?
I don't say the local solution of Aron's got created. I'm saying that something similar
qualitatively
appears when GR is included, and that is there in the Philipov et al. 2018 paper, Philipov and Spitkovsky 2018 paper. That is included. But this figure I've taken from a previous paper just. To illustrate the distribution of Lorentz factors of the charged particles in this entire magnetosphere. And you can see that it is in the current sheet where the largest Lorentz factors are obtained. And so that's because this is the region where you have large uncompensated electric fields. You have E dot B, which is large, as well as this is the region where there is a large departure from your Goldratt-Julien current. In fact, the current is going the other way. Yes. Goldratt-Julien current, if the Goldratt-Julien current is outside, here the current is inside, and vice versa. Okay. Now, this is from the Philipov and Spitkovsky paper again. You have, now you can see this region which gets populated because of GR. But this is not Lorentz factor, but this is now photon density. So now each of these particles is emitting radiation. So at any point of time, you can find what is the emissivity at each region of the magnetosphere. And that you can then convert to what is the local photon density at any given point of time. And since this is a more or less a steady state solution, there are some spatial fluctuations which occur, but that's over time this is a near steady state solution. So therefore you can then go back and plot the stationary photon density in this as a function of space. And this is what it shows. This is a photon number density, a function of space. So you can see that most of the emission is getting initiated near this Y point, which is at the edge of the light cylinder, you know, where the last closed field line touches the light cylinder. And the separatrix is illuminated, but then you don't get much radiation all the way down the separatrix. Although the particles are present, what's happening is that as these particles get injected here and then start moving in, they start encountering larger and larger magnetic field.
So the pair produce?
They lose their energy.
But they will also keep on pair producing and the photons?
No. Because they lose their energy, they stop producing photons. And because they stop producing photons, you don't get, you get pair injection, but smaller in number.
Okay, so it's by radiation reaction they are losing.
Yeah. So the energy goes down.
So what happened to those charge particles?
They go to the surface. These are the ingoing charge particles. Outgoing charge particles, of course, will go outside. They'll not go in. So those which go in, they, as they move in, they see an increasing magnetic field. And so they lose their energy very, very quickly. So you illuminate for a while, and then you don't have, or you run out of juice, basically. Nothing to do.
What is the reason for this small bright, for the small bright?
These?
Those.
So that detail I cannot get by just reading the paper. One may have to go through the solution in more detail. So the idea is that most of the action gets initiated here. And then airs are flowing in both directions. And large number of pairs keep radiating over here. Also, pair multiplicity continues to rise as you go here because there is continued acceleration of the particles in the current sheet. So this is the reason why the region starting from the base of the last closed field lines at the light cylinder to some region outside the light cylinder becomes the brightest in high energy emission that is emitted. And this is what is happening close to the stellar surface. So you have these different regions. This is the closed field line region. And then you have this region, which is the region hugging the last closed field line, where J parallel divided by JGJ is less than zero, which is one condition when you will have uncompensated electric field and you will have pair production. This means that this is a return current. So if the Goldberg-Julian current is supposed to be in one direction, this actual current is in the opposite direction. So it's a return current. Then there are these regions where J parallel by JGJ is less than one, which is perfectly fine. You can short out all the electric field and sustain that current. Here, there is this region which is between these white lines where J parallel by JGJ is greater than 1. This is happening once you include GR. So it is in this region where, again, you will have acceleration. Electric field cannot be fully compensated. And then if you follow the spatial distribution of particle energies in this region, then here is P parallel and here is r by radius of the star, then you can see that you are okay, so in this red ones are positrons, blue ones are electrons, and you can see that there is acceleration here with p parallel rising to large values. But in this simulation, they also see a sign of some instability. In the sense, you see this particle density is not uniform, but it undergoes oscillations here. So it's kind of bunching that is apparent from this. The scales are very big, of course, but in that sense, all the parameters here are scaled. They're not realistic parameters of a true pulsar. But qualitatively, this in the process of particle acceleration and pair generation is seen to have a kind of intermittent behavior with high density bunches and then gaps and high density bunches and gaps and so on. And this appears to be due to the fact that you produce particles and then they move and then they can short out some of the electric fields, accelerating fields, therefore acceleration stops. But then once that stops, the current density goes down and then the accelerating voltage starts again. So there is the interplay between these charge particles, space charge shorting out the electric field and electric field accelerating particles. And at least in this solution, they find these oscillations, which is reminiscent of what you might need if you want to produce coherent radio emission with large number of particles. But you cannot take these numbers at face value, because this is not a problem with real scales.
But now in this case, when they are doing, it is basically, now they are not neglecting the inertia of the particles,
no.
Right? So now as it's positive.
So ions and positrons, they behave differently because the inertia is different.
But for positron, technically, they also assume that the particle which are getting emitted, they are ions. But later on in the pair production, that is electron and positron, right?
Yes.
Magnetosphere.
And ions get accelerated, they produce, but they don't, they participate in the current.
But outward current.
Outward current, but they don't get created in pair production. And
ions are not getting created,
no.
But positrons are getting created.
That is right.
Then if they have incorporated this kind of inertia of the particle, then why this thing doesn't show up in positron actually, this kind of bunching thing?
No, it probably is there. It's just that here the E dot B must be such that electrons are getting outward moving electrons are getting accelerated. Positrons may be moving in, or I'm not sure exactly what is the. But clearly, the sign of the electric field is such that one sign of charge gets accelerated much more than the other sign. So, electrons.
So these positrons and electrons are basically now two separate population in phase space, basically.
Yes, yes. So this is a phase space diagram.
And they have different distribution property altogether.
Yes. That's correct. And then here again, now going further out, that was very close to the star. This is two times the stellar radius. So that is in that tiny gap, basically within this diagram. This is the polar cap part of the radiation, particle generation. But as you saw in the overall scheme of things, in the high energy radiation, this contributes very little. If you go to the photon density, you see a certain enhancement in photon density over here for high energy emission. But the large dominance comes from this region. And then here, this is plotted over a larger distance, multiple things which are plotted. These thick lines are particle trajectories, and these colors on those particle trajectories represent the Lorentz factor of the particle. Magenta is the highest Lorentz factor in these plots. So you can see that highest energy particles are getting created down there. They're not close to the star, but they're out here, which is the same region which I showed you before, in this region. And that's why when you go to very high energy radiation, those are the regions which become more relevant. And then you can follow the generation of particles, their Lorentz factors, the radiation they produce. And this is in the outflowing wind. What is the energy distribution of particles? You have electrons, positrons, and ions. As a function of Lorentz factor, gamma Pc is the full polar cap potential drop, which in this case is limited to 500. So that's the particle energy distribution, and then from that you can compute the emission, nu f nu, and you will get the electrons and positrons. Ions are not considered for radiation because
this one is basically spectrum. This is the emission from electron and positron.
Hmm?
Contribution from electron.
Electron and positron in the total spectrum, and the total spectrum is the dashed line. So you can, having come this far, you can now construct all these quantities and look at the radiation that has been produced.
Also, the distribution function of the ions, you can see a dip there. So is there a prominent reason why?
Yeah, so that's at gamma or gamma Pc of about 10 to the power minus 2. Yeah. And that may have to do with the ions which have which have lost their energy in generating primary photons which gave rise to pairs. So then those would have moved to lower energy. So suppose you had initially a distribution like that, then if below a certain energy you have particles contributing, then they will move.
Would not have seen a dip there, would have seen a consistent flattening.
Not necessarily. Depends on what energy spectrum was injected, and then where, what radiation took place for to drain energy of the particles. Again, to really understand the details, one has to go into more carefully through the actual calculations.
So this is what we see in the wind. So this is the thing that is going out of the box.
Yeah. This is what will exit the box.
So what's gamma Pc exactly?
Gamma Pc is the full potential drop in the polar cap. Which, as I said, in the case of crab, it could be gamma Pc, it could be of the order of 10 million to 10 to the 10. Whereas here, gamma Pc is limited to 500.
So, potential drop from like starts from polar cap and ends at the
yes.
Thing,
it's a basically pole to equator drop.
Pole to equator.
Yeah.
Then why is it scaled for different these all these quantities?
Yeah, so this is all scaled to that gamma PC. This plot.
In this case, it was kept the same for all the three, right?
No. Gamma PC was kept the same for all the three, but. So what's the question?
So why is it being scaled?
It's not giving actual numbers. You scale it with gamma PC. So the idea is that, okay, so now I take gamma PC 2 10 to the 10. Then I might be able to then correspondingly scale what is the actual gamma distribution that I will get.
But gamma PC actually can come directly from the vacuum solution, right?
No. Yeah, you can get it from the vacuum solution.
Yes.
But
but it will decay and it will go down after
go down
the steady solution
yeah.
has achieved.
Yeah. And in the wind zone, what this shows here is the energy distribution. N gamma divided by mgj. This is so it shows you that this distribution, this is theta and phi. Okay, so the spatial distribution is not uniform. There is significant non-homogeneity in the distribution of particle energy distribution. This is as a function of theta. This is three things. This blue line is energy density. Blue line is one of these. I think this is the energy density. This is the number density, and this is the individual particle energy. So.
Dibankar, like, what are the typical Sturrock factors
that
you see here?
What factors?
The Sturrock factor.
I don't know. Because everything is controlled here. So, multiplicity is also controlled. So, if I don't remember how much is the multiplicity, maximum they are produced. If the multiplicity goes beyond 100 or so, they just cut it.
Okay.
So these are not realistic numbers that you will get in the actual magnetosphere. But to keep track of it numerically, you will have to cut it some point. Otherwise, you just don't have enough computation time. And this is the sigma, which is the magnetic energy density to kinetic energy density ratio of the plasma. That also has large range in the wind zone. This dark zone is the highest, 30 here, and the blue is the lowest. So this is the current sheet. And in the current sheet, the plasma is hot. So the kinetic energy density of the plasma is high. So the sigma goes down. In the outer region, the kinetic energy density of the plasma is lower.
What is this? What is this?
Sigma is the ratio of magnetic energy density to kinetic energy density.
That is there written sigma in there.
So because the plasma is hot in the current sheet, the sigma is lower there, and outside sigma is higher. So this continues for the region all the way out to the edge of the box. Remember, this is theta, this is phi. So this is basically a two-dimensional plot of the distribution. And here is the photon trajectories, and sort of endpoints of photon trajectories as seen here. Red ones are outgoing photons and blue ones. So red ones are photons emitted by outgoing particles. Yellow ones are photons emitted by incoming particles. So the beam will be directed outside for the red ones, the beam will be directed inside for the red ones.
If you go back to the earlier plot, so this is theta from 0 to pi. 0 to pi, and that is from
0 to 2 pi.
Pi is. But they have done it at a particular radius, right?
This is at the edge of the wind zone.
At the edge of the wind zone.
Yeah. So that means the farthest point.
Yes, of the box. Yeah,
yeah. It's for 60 degree inclination of the rotator. It's also for 60 degree inclination of the rotator. So you can see that this there is a significant amount of particles moving in both directions near the Y point, but as you come out, the particles are moving mainly outward, so that's what carries the wind into the magnet. Now you can collect those. And you can do your exercise distributed in the theta phi plane, and you'll get a certain pattern. This is for 60 degrees, you can do it for any inclination you like. And then you will have to cut it depending on your line of sight. So for different lines of sight, if you cut, you get these different path shapes. This is not to say that this is exactly reproducing the observed path shape of any pulsar, but qualitatively it reproduces the general nature of the path shape. So this is as far as these calculations have got. Okay. It's still very far away from using realistic parameters, but many qualitative features come out of these solutions, which resemble what we see in pulsars. Yeah.
Actually, the plot that they have given in this profile, they are of all of different line of sight, and they show the one of them goes up.
Yeah.
But this is actually bolometric, right?
This is bolometric. It's counting all the photon trajectories.
No, actually in crab with lower energy, they have this shorter, and with high energy, it goes up and again it goes down.
Line of sight doesn't change.
Line of sight doesn't change. So initially, but then again, line of sight is fixed.
Yes. You should only take this qualitatively.